Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you. to all of you. It is good when the sisters and brothers gather together in unity, as we do today. The meal after the committal, because of COVID mitigation, will be for the family only. I invite you now to stand and to face the bench. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy and the God of all consolation, who comforts us in all our sorrows, so that we can comfort others in their sorrows with the consolation we ourselves have received from God.
Thanks be to God.
When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall surely be united with him in a resurrection like his.
Amen.
We join in the first two verses of Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee.
His head. As She continued praying before the Lord. Eli observed her mouth. Hannah was speaking in her heart. Only her lips moved, and her voice was not heard. Therefore, Eli took her to be a drunken woman. And Eli said to her, "How long will you be drunken? Put away your wine from you." But Hannah answered, "No, my lord, I am a woman sorely troubled. I have drunk neither wine nor strong drink, but I have been pouring out my soul before the Lord. Do not regard your maidservant as a base woman, for all along I have been speaking out of great anxiety and vexation." Then Eli answered, "Go in peace, and the God of Israel grant your petition, which you have made to him." And she said, "Let your maidservant find favor in your eyes." Then the woman went her way and ate, and her countenance was no longer sad. They rose early in the morning and worshiped before the Lord. Then they went back to the house of Ramah. And Elkanah knew Hannah, his wife, and the Lord remembered her. And in due time, Hannah conceived and bore a son, and she called his name Samuel, for she said, "I have asked him of the Lord."
Psalms 46. God is our refuge and strength, the very present help in trouble. Therefore we will not fear, though the earth is moved, and the mountains shake, and the depths of the sea, though the waters rage and foam, and though the mountains tremble with its tumult. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of the city. It shall not be shaken. God shall help it in the break of day. The nations rage and the kingdoms shake. God speaks and the earth melts away. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. Come now, regard the works of the Lord. What dilacerations God has brought up on the earth. Behold the one who makes war cease in all the world, who breaks the bow and shatters the spear and burns the shields with fire. Be still then, and now that I am God, I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of the hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
Reading from the book of Revelation. And he said to me, "These words are trustworthy and true, for the Lord, the God of the spirits of the prophets, has sent his angel to show his servants what must soon take place. See, I am coming soon. Blessed is the one who keeps the words of the prophecy of this book. I, John, am the one who heard and saw these things. And when I heard and saw them, I fell down to worship at the feet of the angel who showed them to me. But he said to me, 'You must not do that. I am a fellow servant with you and your comrades, the prophets, and with those who keep the words of the book, worship of God.' And he said to me, 'Do not seal up the words of the prophecy of this book, for the time is near. Let the evildoer still do evil, and the filthy still be filthy, and the righteous still be right, and the holy still be holy. See, I am coming soon. My reward is with me to repay according to everyone's work. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes so that they will have the right to the tree of life and the gate of the city by the gates. Outside are the dogs and the sorcerers and the fornicators and the murderers and the idolaters and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. It is I, Jesus, who sent my angel to you with this testimony for the churches. I am the root and the descendant of David, the bright morning star. The Spirit and the bride say, come. And let everyone who hears say, come. And let everyone who is thirsty come. Let anyone who wishes take the water of life as a gift. I warn everyone who hears the words of the prophecy of this book. If anyone adds to them, God will add to that person the plagues described in this book. If anyone who takes away from the words of this book of this prophecy, God will take away that person's share in the tree of life and in the holy city, which are described in this book. The one who testifies to these things says, surely I am coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with all the saints. Amen.
The Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Please stand as you are. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave the power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory. The glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. John testified to him and cried out, this was he of whom I said, he who comes after me ranks ahead of me, because he was before me. From his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. The law indeed was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. It is God the only Son, who is close to the Father's heart, who has made him known. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Grace and peace to you from God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. On behalf of the Central Southern Illinois Synod, and on behalf of the broader Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, let me express our gratitude to God for the ministry of Pastor John Schmalen. His faithful service, his commitment to those around him, and his devotion to the triune God who claimed him, redeemed him, and never let him go. To you, Susan, and all of you, family, please know that you have our deepest condolences, and you have our prayers. Thank you. Christian faith was at the center of who Pastor John was. It formed him as a citizen, as a soldier, as a husband, father, grandfather, great-grandfather, and more broadly, as a disciple of the Lord Jesus. Does anyone here have more titles in front of her or his name? Than the Reverend Colonel Dr. Sir Ron Peterson. Well, I don't. You have to read his obituary two or three times to hold all of that stuff together in your head. Such a wide range of experiences he had. How many pastors do you know that had part of their training take place in a federal penitentiary? I mean, voluntarily in a federal penitentiary. Right? I learned of the Sir part of his titles. I learned of that piece of the story shortly after I became the Synod Bishop. And Pastor John sent to me, Sir John, sent to me this rendition of his coat of arms, which was created by a parishioner that he had in Shelbyville, who then moved to where I lived and was one of my parishioners in the parish in Jacksonville before I was elected bishop. First call. His first call was founding Trinity Lutheran Church, Linton, Indiana. And those of you who are from around here, you know that Linton isn't that far north of here, right? Yeah. It is peculiarly fitting that the bishop of the Indiana Kentucky Synod and the Central Southern Illinois Synod would come together to bring to fullness Pastor John's ministry. Because his first call in Linton was in the state of Indiana, but it was a congregation of the Illinois district of the American Lutheran Church, one of the predecessor church bodies of the ELCA. What a storied military career he had. As a Lutheran chaplain, Pastor John submitted an annual report to the ELCA for his chaplaincy service. Let me give you a snapshot of one small part of one report that he sent that I think gives us a sense of the, you know, speaks volumes to who Colonel Schraling was. In a 1993 report on that form, the form asked for a declaration, for a narrative description, rather, a narrative description of duties. And in the lines after that, there were three lines in the space after that available. And he wrote, Command Staff Chaplain for Engineers with responsibilities in the U.S. and 19 countries of Southwest Asia, the Pacific, Korea, Central and South America. No small tasks, right? But wait. The next line asks, problems encountered. And his answer was very short, non-significant. Doesn't that sound like someone who's unflappable? When Mount Zion, Mount Carmel, celebrated its 175th anniversary, they asked me to preach, and to preach in German, which is what services were in England, German 175 years ago.
Okay, I did. But I had to brush up on my German. Because Pastor John was going to be there. And I knew that he could understand what I was saying. Let me say something directly to the people of Zion and our Savior. You know how much he fed and nourished your faith in his years of ministry with you. I want you to know that his annual report, in his annual minister's report that comes to the bishop every year, in the one that I received just last month from him, he had this note: I find fulfillment spiritually in the ministry that I am doing at Zion and our Savior. He was being fed as he was feeding you. From coaching high school track, basketball, and football to vice president for instructional services and dean of the faculty at Vincennes University, jetting around the world doing development work for his beloved Wartburg Seminary. And with you, whom he so cherished, being husband, father, grandfather, and great-grandfather. I would say straight up that many of you knew Pastor John better than I did. And when it comes to stories about Pastor John, you are the ones who have the story. And recalling those stories is wonderful. And all the glowing things that you have said and heard about Pastor John are true and valuable. But there is something that matters more. Like all of us, Pastor John was a sinner in need of God's grace, God's redemption, God's love and forgiveness. Nothing that Pastor John or you or I could ever do could conquer sin, death, and the power of the devil. Only God could do that. Pastor John's stories, life stories, are bound up in the larger story of the Christian gospel. Pastor John himself could not imagine being without the promises of the gospel. The promise of the Christmas story and the incarnation of God in Jesus, which is that God is with us. And then the promise that God defeats sin, death, and the power of the evil one in his crucifixion and resurrection. The larger story is embedded in all of the scripture readings, actually, that Pastor John chose for this service. In parts. In the Psalm, the Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. In the Gospel, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. In the book of Revelation, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes so that they may enter the city by the gates. I want to lift up one of those. Psalm 46 speaks of danger and hope. Authentic hope. Authentic hope in the midst of real danger. In the Bible, physical danger and spiritual danger get all mixed up together so that when you're in danger spiritually, it has an effect on you physically. And when you're in danger physically, it has an effect on you spiritually. It's all mixed up, all bound together. And that's the way it is in Psalm 46. That's the way it is with the world. The danger and the hope. And hope wins. Because the Lord of hosts is with us. And the God of Jacob reference to any of the Bible translations that we used, and even the one that was that we used for today. But there is a missing word in Psalm 46. And it's missing from the printed rendition of it that we have in the bulletin. The missing word is Selah. It's a Hebrew word. Now, the reason that Selah doesn't get translated is because nobody really knows what it means. Now, but it's used three times in this very short psalm. We will not fear, though the earth should change, though the mountains shake and part of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble with its tumult. Selah. And then two times, the Lord of hosts is with us, the God of Jacob is our refuge. Selah. So what does Selah mean? Well, imagine, and why it's untranslatable. We don't actually know kind of what it means, but we just can't translate it. Imagine that it's the bottom of the ninth, you're down by a run, there's one runner on, two outs at the bottom of the ninth, and your batter hits the home run, and you jump up, and you shout out. That shout is the Selah. Selah expresses explosive happiness, relief, triumph, celebration, fulfillment, and gratitude, all rolled into one word. Pastor John's obituary speaks of an amazing life. And recalling that is comforting and gratifying in a number of ways. But the obituary and the stories we've heard about Pastor John, those are not the complete story. They are not the complete story without the Selah. The hymns and prayers and praises of the people of God, gathered in gratitude to God for Pastor John, providing the Selah to Pastor John's passing, that's what fulfills the story. Let me make it very clear to you why you are here today, in this place, at this time, in the eyes of heaven. You are here for the Selah in Pastor John's transition to the church triumphant. You are here for the Selah. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Selah. Now help me out with this. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness shall not overcome it.
Selah.
I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed, blessed, blessed are those who wash their robes so they may enter the city by the gates. Selah. Selah. I invite you to join me together in the first two verses of Glories of Your Name.
Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Joined as one by our baptism into Christ, we pray together as Jesus taught.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day
Let us commend our brother John to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant John Peter Schmidt. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in life.
Amen.
Let us go forth in peace.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
We sing verses 1 and 4 of Almighty Fortress.